Ladies and gentlemen.
Can you see through it?
No.
Yes.
It's a ball. Is that what it is?
BDS.
It says.
Oh, so you want it.
It's a little worn for wear. I will talk about it.
I mean, we can have a little conversation if you want, but to tell you the truth, my message now after, I've also been on a journey with this whole thing. And when we began our work, I think the idea of how do we get out of this mess, where are we going together, critical Israelis, certainly, and Palestinians, it was towards a two-state solution. In other words, that was still alive, that was still kind of the agenda, and we felt in our work, we focused on the issue of house demolitions, and the head of the Israeli Committee Against House Demolitions, as a vehicle towards working to resolve this conflict. In other words, the house demolition issue, Israel's demolished close to 50,000 Palestinian homes in the occupied territory only, the West Bank, East Jerusalem, and Gaza, since 1967, since the occupation began. That's on the backdrop, of course, of another probably 60,000 or so homes that were destroyed systematically in the Nakba, 1948 and after. We know something like 530 entire villages, towns, urban areas of Palestinians were erased and destroyed at that time. Plus another, thousands of homes inside Israel of Israeli citizens, all of whom are Arab, between 1948 and ongoing today. For example, some of you know the village of, the community of Al-Hiran in the Nakab, in the Negev Desert. Has been demolished numbers of times. There was someone killed about a month or two ago. The Bedouin community of Al-Araqib in the Negev, in the Nakab, has been demolished more than 100 times and rebuilt by activists and by the community. So house demolition is really a part of, and this is a very important concept, Judaization. Now, when people hesitate to use it, partly because it sounds a little anti-Semitic, although it's actually an official term that was used by the Zionist movement for the last century, but also by the Israeli government as an official policy. We're Judaizing Jerusalem. That's an official policy. It isn't just some slogan. We're Judaizing the Galilee. And of course, the concept of Judaization is really what's behind Zionism and the State of Israel, which is, writ large, transforming Palestine into the land of Israel. So part of it is Judaization. We replace the Arabic names with Hebrew names, the mountains, the rivers, the towns, the communities are all Hebrewized. And actually, there's an Israeli historian named Miron Benvenisti, if you want to look up his book. He wrote a book called Sacred Landscape. He was actually the deputy mayor of Jerusalem at one point, who writes about this whole process of Judaization, changing the names. His father was actually on the committee appointed by Ben-Gurion in 1948 to Judaize the country, to completely change the name. So, it was an actual formal, declared, official process. Besides, of course, the displacement of Palestinians and replacing them with Jewish settlers and Jewish immigrants and so on. And, of course, the flip side then of Judaization would be de-Arabization of the country, and really erasing completely the Palestinian presence, its history, identity from the land, and so on. So this is really, if you want to kind of conceptualize what this process was and continues to be, you know, beyond occupation, apartheid, ethnic cleansing, settler colonialism, all the words that we use, I would say the big overall term would be Judaization. It's a hard concept to use, partly because it sounds that way, but also because, you know, it doesn't have a legal reference. You know, if you talk about occupation or apartheid, you know, you can go to UN conventions, there's laws about apartheid. In other words, there's ways to enforce, I mean, it's not easy to enforce, to implement laws that have to do with those sorts of things. Judaization, of course, isn't a legal concept. It's more of a political concept. And in a sense, I would then argue, and this is why I think all of us feel or know that the two-state solution is gone. And the reason is because the process of Judaization has gone so far that it's really complete. And we're talking about a century-long process, project. Certainly since 1967 with the occupation, I mean, you know, unlimited funds. We're talking about billions and billions and billions of dollars have been invested in this project. You know, there's, you know, East Jerusalem is really gone. I would argue there is no more East Jerusalem. If you're talking about, I mean, we're sitting in some ways in East Jerusalem, in the old city, but if you're talking about a city with some, that's a coherent city with territory, an economy, an urban life, there is no more East Jerusalem. It really has been Judaized. And of course, East Jerusalem was annexed to Israel formally, officially, 50 years ago. So it's 50 years of Judaizing this part of the city. There are today as many, if not more, Israelis living in East Jerusalem as there are Palestinians. And of course, Israelis live in a contiguous area, whereas the Palestinian East Jerusalem is then reduced to today a bunch of little islands. And so I would really argue there is no more East Jerusalem, and I would go on to argue, actually, that there is no more occupation, that there is no more West Bank, that in fact the Judaization process has gone to a point where the West Bank has been transformed into Judea and Samaria. With Palestinian islands, you know, areas A and B. You know, area C, as you know, is about 62% of the West Bank that contains, with East Jerusalem, about 800,000 settlers in about 200 settlements, but not just settlements. And you all know that settlements under states minimizes the reality. The reality is, you know, Maale Adumim is a city of 40,000 people. Beitar Elite, between Bethlehem and Hebron, is about 50, 60,000 people. I mean, there's other, you know, a lot of these settlements are really satellite cities with an infrastructure of highways that connect them into Israel and so on. So that really, really what I'm saying is, not only has Israel eliminated the two-state solution, and eliminated it consciously and deliberately and systematically. This wasn't a mistake. Oh, we woke up one day and all of a sudden we're surprised. This was the intention. And that's why the house demolition issue is so powerful. Because with the house demolition issue, you can see Israel's intentions. In other words, 50,000 homes have been demolished, not for security reasons. You see, because what Israel, the way Israel frames it and tries to sell it to the public, is that everything we do is for security. It's against terrorism, for defense, we're just defending ourselves, we're not responsible, we're the victims. You see? And to be a victim is a very powerful place to be, because if you're the victim, things happen to you, and you can't be held responsible for anything, because you're the victim. And so, you know, from that point of view, then, you know, Israel, you know, could say, well, we wanted peace. You know, you hear this all the time. Right. We wanted peace. We tried to have peace. Barak's generous offer for peace. The Palestinians are the ones that resist. The Palestinians are the ones that refuse, reject. And so Israel has really managed, by using security and terrorism and all these words that are so, of course, emotional and so, you know, in a sense, irrational terms, it succeeded in taking over the country, Judaizing the country, eliminating the two-state solution, but blaming the Palestinians for it. You see, and what the house demolition issue does that we work on is it says, oh, wait a minute, look, there's 50,000 homes that have been demolished and not for security. In other words, less than, well, about 1% of the homes that have been demolished since 1967 had anything to do with security, attacks in any way. So in 99% of the cases, literally, and we have it documented, security has nothing to do with it. Homes were demolished either under military assaults. For example, the assault on Gaza in 2014, Operation Protective Edge, Israel demolished 18,000 Palestinian homes within those 3 weeks that have never been rebuilt. And you know, you're here a little bit, it hasn't been too cold in your time, but you know, Gaza, you know, people think the Middle East, camels, sun, you know, they don't realize that Gaza can be a pretty cold place in the winter. Now, since 2014, hundreds of thousands of people with no homes at all. So that, and these homes were not targeted. In other words, it isn't that they're homes that were targeted by the army for some reason. They were simply collateral damage. They were in the way. So that homes are, and of course, one of the most famous was in 2002, in what was called Operation Defensive Shield, where Israel really destroyed tens of thousands of homes within Palestinian cities, including the whole Jenin refugee camp. So that's one way Israel demolishes. It has nothing to do with security. It's simply clearing the table, in a sense, under military operations. And the second, of course, is that since 1967, Israel does not give building permits to Palestinians to build new homes. And this is true, by the way, inside Israel. This is one of the reasons why Judaization is such an important concept, because it doesn't confine itself to the... It isn't like there's an occupation, and we're against that, and Israel's fine. There's no difference, really, in the position of Palestinians on either side of the Green Line. I mean, it's true, Palestinians in Israel have citizenship, but it's a formal kind of a citizen. It doesn't really give them any particular benefits, not in housing. They're also not allowed to build. You know, the Palestinian citizens of Israel are 20% of the Israeli population, and they're confined by planning and zoning and so on to about 3.5% of the land. So that their status is this much better than that of Palestinians in the occupied territory. If you look at the Israeli flag, you can see that even though they're citizens, they're certainly not represented as, you know, the flag represents one particular group in the country. So in a sense, then, this Judaization process is countrywide, and it has nothing to do with security. But you see, that's where house demolitions become, it allows us to reframe the conflict. Because, wait a minute, if these houses were not demolished for security, if this particular house, and David knows, for example, we work with one family, the Shawamri family, whose home has been demolished 6 times, and they come sometimes out on speaking tours with me, and we have slideshows. I was in all the demolitions. We have a slideshow, and Salim, sometimes his wife, Arabia, talk about it, and there's nothing security in it. He's never been political, he never did anything, he was never charged with anything. He can show, here's my house, here I am in my house, Here comes the army, here's the bulldozers, they demolished my home, and here I'm standing in the ruins of my home. In other words, he wasn't arrested. He didn't do anything illegal, except maybe in the sense of rebuilding his home, but I mean, he wasn't arrested for that. So that security had nothing to do with, so you simply ask the question, why was this particular family, and here's their picture, why was their home demolished? And so-called pro-Israel advocates can't explain it. Because the only explanation they have for Israel's policies is security. Well, there is no security. So, in other words, it forces them to admit, although they'll never do it, that these are proactive policies of taking over the country and ethnic cleansing. There's no other explanation for the demolition of this family's home. And Israel, of course, does not grant building permits to Palestinians. Well, you know, this is 50 years now. You have children, your children have children, you have to live somewhere, and so you end up building a home illegally. So it's really blaming the victim. It's criminalizing everyday life. And in order to have a normal life in a home, which is a fundamental human right, you have to become a criminal. Or not a criminal, but you have to become an illegal offender in order to have a home, and then your home can be demolished. So what I'm arguing then is, and this is where we are today, is that Israel intentionally and deliberately and consciously eliminated the two-state solution. It's gone. There was never any time, even in the brightest days of Oslo, that Israel ever really considered a viable, real, sovereign Palestinian state. It was never in the cards. And it eliminated that. We can see that today. And in fact, today there already is one state.
Right.
I mean, the whole argument, one state or two states, is really gone. There is one state. You can't get into this country without going through an Israeli border. You know, there's one effective government. Don't tell me the Palestinian Authority is really the government that governs. There's obviously one army that controls the entire country. The Palestinian militia is a collaborationist one, but it's not an army per se. I mean, the Israeli army controls the entire country. There's only one currency. Whether you're in Gaza or Hebron or Tel Aviv, you're using the shekel. That's controlled by the Bank of Israel. There's only one legal system. There's only one water system, electrical system, highway system. And in other words, by any measure, there already is one de facto country here between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River. Geographically, in terms of the facts on the ground, there's one country. And it's an apartheid state. Now we have a UN agency yesterday, if you saw the news, that actually, for the first time, said that. But it is an apartheid state. And it's apartheid because, you know, apartheid isn't just a slogan. I mean, there's definitions of apartheid. It's actually a law against what's called the crime of apartheid. And it's not unique to South Africa. It's when one population separates itself from the others. So that's the apart in apartheid. Apartheid means separateness in Afrikaans. So one population separates itself from the others. Well, you just have to look at the Israeli flag and you can see that that's the case. And then that dominant population creates a permanent institutionalized regime of domination over the others. It isn't Jim Crow. It isn't just discrimination. It's the regime, it's the laws, it's the concept, it's official, it's legal. So in the United States, I mean, the reason why the civil rights movement could succeed is because really it had the backing of the Constitution and American law. I mean, the United States said we're a democracy of equal rights. And so, in a sense, the civil rights movement was able to use that, and the courts couldn't The courts had, in a sense, to back that up, because that's what the Constitution, you know, it was a process, and I'm not saying it's ideal, certainly in the U.S., but you've got that, the backing of the fact that the concept and the laws of the American regime, if you want to say, the American government, is equal rights under democracy. Whereas here, or in an apartheid state, that's not the case. The official rules of the game privilege one group over others and say this country belongs not to its citizens, even in an abstract way, it belongs officially to one particular people. Whether it's the Afrikaners in South Africa or the Israeli Jews here, you know, and again, it's reflected in the flag. And so the laws, in other words, Palestinians or people that want equality and so on, have no legal way to do that. That was the problem in South Africa. You couldn't go to courts and overturn apartheid decisions because that was the law. You see, there wasn't anything higher than that. And that's the case here. Palestinians have nowhere to appeal to, except, of course, there is a concept of international law,
right,
which is supposed to trump, excuse the expression. There's got to be a better word. Overweigh national law. I mean, the concept of international law is that once it's passed through the UN system and becomes either common law or international law, that every government has to change its laws to conform to it. Don't tell the American Supreme Court this, but the highest court in the world is the International Court of Justice in The Hague. It's supposed to, according to the rules of the game, even overrule the American Supreme Court, because there are international laws that the entire international community have agreed upon. But you know, that's all on paper. I mean, the laws are there. There is a law, and it's called the Convention, I think, against the crime of apartheid. That's what it's called. There is a law. There's laws against everything Israel's doing. The Fourth Geneva Convention is, you know, in black and white. You're not allowed to move your civilian population into an occupied territory. You're not allowed to change the status of an occupied territory. You're not allowed to build settlements. You're not allowed to build highways. You're not allowed to do anything that Israel's done. Annex. The problem is, of course, implementation. Who's going to implement international law? So it doesn't really help us too much that this international law exists, because there's no implementation. So just to end up this thought, the problem that is that Israel has created one state, an apartheid state, and the only pushback is really political pushback. BDS is part of it. The BDS movement, boycotts, divestments, sanctions. A lot of the campaigns we do and so on, we push back politically. But here's where we have a problem. This is the main thing that I'm talking about these days. And I'll be frank about it. You know, Israel has a solution. The solution is apartheid. Israel says, yes, this is, and it's very upfront, this is where we're going. We want to annex Area C, and I think what's coming down the pipeline is something interesting. I think there's a good chance that Gaza, I think Hamas could sign a separate peace with Israel. You know? And Gaza, we're beginning to see signs of it, that Gaza would become an independent Palestinian state of its own. Hamas, just last week, changed its charter to recognize Israel within the 67 boundaries, officially. Trump met with the Saudi Arabians, I think, yesterday. And, you know, it's the Saudi Arabians and the Gulf states that really support Hamas. Without them, they don't have any financial support. And Egypt, of course, which is very close to Israel. Even Lieberman, our crazy defense minister, is talking about rebuilding the seaport in Gaza. They're talking about building an island off Gaza that would be a seaport and an airport, really developing, giving more work permits. In other words, if you read between the lines, something is gelling here. And it makes sense because Gaza is, nobody wants Gaza. Egypt doesn't want it. Israel doesn't want it. You know, and if nothing happens, I mean, according to the UN, it's going to become uninhabitable this year, 2017, because of the water and the pollution and everything else. So that makes sense. That means then that Israel takes over Area C and expands from 78% of the country today to 85% of the country. Gaza is cut off. Gaza becomes its own little country. And then we're left with A and B, areas A and B. Not our problem as Israelis. We don't want to rule over them. That's the problem of the international community. Palestinian Authority can stay if it wants to. If not, you know, something that's been suggested is that the UN would impose a kind of protectorate over A and B. In other words, we're heading towards an internationally sanctioned apartheid regime. Because if Israel takes Area C, everybody's going to complain and moan and groan and everything else, but they'll let it happen in the end. And Gaza, of course, would be okay. And A and B, okay. So, you know, the people of A and B will become wards of the UN. And then it's over. So Israel's solution is very clear, which is an international regime, an apartheid regime, that can be supported by, even governed by, to some degree, the international community. Okay, well, what's our... All right, now, we don't like that, of course. I don't think any of us accept apartheid. We're all for Palestinian rights. What are we suggesting? What's our pushback? Nothing. We don't have a plan. The Palestinians, our partners and civil society don't have a plan. We don't have a plan. Yeah, the one-state solution is floating. A couple people kind of talk about it, but nobody's really developed what that means. We're not even political actors. That's what I'm saying. And that is, governments do not resolve conflicts. They manage conflicts. And they're happy to manage this one. If apartheid means managing this, so they're happy to do it. International law, human rights, justice, these are not concepts that guide government policies. They're ridiculous to governments. I mean, Jimmy Carter was laughed out of office because he tried to make human rights a guiding principle of foreign policy. So if we want a solution that's just and workable, and viable, we have to come up with it. We the people, meaning first and foremost Palestinians. I can't represent Palestinians, certainly, and you can't represent Palestinians. I mean, some of you might be Palestinian origin at least, but you know you're not going to liberate Palestine from old Lyme or new Lyme or any Lyme. You know, so while I cut the Palestinians all the slack in the world, I mean, they're exhausted, they're battered, they're fragmented, they're living under a collaborationist Palestinian Authority. You know, Palestinians say we're living under two occupations. Still, nobody can articulate where we're going except them, basically. It's their struggle. Now, we can support them, we on the in the Israeli peace camp, the critical Israelis, and I think we have to be a part of it. We're stakeholders as well. You're not going to do this alone. You know, this has to be done together with Israelis. And we have to formulate, and then once we formulate a just solution where we're going, then we turn to you, and then your job is to support us and push it forward. So, just to give you an example, we've always supported BDS. ICAN, our organization. Matter of fact, we supported BDS before it was called BDS. But BDS is a tool. What are we BDSing for? What are we BDSing for? We don't have a program. What I'm trying now, I'm simply, and I'm pushing the envelope here because I know, you know, and people tell me sometimes, this isn't your role. You're overstepping. You shouldn't tell us what to do. You know, and you're a colonialist anyway, you know, being an Israeli. So, you know, but I'm still trying to push, because without a political, without a program of our own, we're not actors. And what I'm trying to say is we have to connect BDS to a political program. We have to, BDS for what? And what I'm advocating for, just, it's not the solution, but I think it's workable, I've written a lot about it, but at least it gets this discussion out. Is BDS for BDS. BDS for a binational democratic state, which I think is where we have to go. In other words, and it seems to me fairly crystal clear. I'm not sure why we're not articulating this. It's not like there's 100 options that we have to choose from. You know, I think what's happened is what we have to do is to say to Israel, and to break this thing that Israel's the victim and so on, to say to Israel, okay, you, Israel, you eliminated the two-state solution. Don't blame the Arabs for that, you know. You created one state in this country. Fine, we go with that, we accept that. But there can't be an apartheid state, obviously. So this state has to be transformed into a democratic state of equal rights for all its citizens. I mean, is that such a brainer for Americans?
No.
A democratic state. Now, having said that, I also want to say that it has to be binational. In other words, this isn't Kansas, where we're all just a bunch of voters. You know, there are two national groups here. And that can't be, whether there should be or shouldn't be is another question. But there is today. Palestinian Arabs and Israeli Jews, and that those national identities can't be swept under the carpet, and we can't pretend that we're just voters. And that's where the binational part comes in. I think both peoples have to acknowledge the existence of the others, and that gives them then also, in a sense, their collective rights are recognized and acknowledged together with their individual rights in democracy. It's a little bit different from the States. It's more like, in some ways, like Canada. Well, Canada, you've got Francophones and Anglophones, and or in the UK, in Britain. You've got four nations in Britain sharing one democratic so far. I mean, next week it could change, but so far you've got the English and the Scots. And the Scots are no less nationalistic than Palestinians are, believe me. And the Northern Irish and the Welsh. And yet they live, you know, you've had Scottish prime ministers, you've had Welsh prime ministers, so, you know, I mean, Spain, we have the Spanish and the Catalonians and the Basques and others. I mean, there's all, you know, the Maoris and in New Zealand, there are other countries, a lot of countries that are most countries are multinational. And so how you deal with that is an issue, because we know sometimes there's a lot of there's civil wars and there's tensions. It's not always easy, even in the UK or Canada, where the French speakers have come close to seceding at different times. But still, you know, there's ways of dealing with these sorts of things. I don't want to mystify our conflict and say, well, it's primordial. We've always hated each other, which isn't true. You know, there's no solution. It's too complex. All this stuff you hear all the time. So I'm saying this, for me, is a political program. Now, it might not be the political program. You know, something else might come, fine. But at least we have to talk about that. And so I feel today, kind of, tell you the truth, a little frustrated. And I mean, if David was at the beginning of ICAN, he's close to the end of ICAN. Because, you know, we've almost stopped a lot of our activities because we can't work alone. in isolation, if we're not part of a political movement towards something, then it's very hard for us to continue. And so that's really, in a sense, I mean, there's nothing you can do about it. I'm just sort of informing you to kind of complete your tour, maybe. But I think this is the next stage that we have to really work on. And I'm trying to talk to our Palestinian partners, which is very hard. The Israeli left is not very strategic either. I think the left all over the world is in a place today where we're not very strategic. And that, I think, is an issue. So that's where I'd like to see us go, at least, towards some kind of a political program.
But this is a non-starter, because Israel wants to name itself a Jewish state, and therefore doesn't want a Palestinian majority, and the Palestinians will be a majority.
That's right.
If you give them voting rights, then it's the end of the Jewish state.
No, for sure.
So how do you make this work? Because they're never going to allow it to happen.
Well, you know, Israelis have never been presented with a real alternative. I mean, they're, what they've been presented is two states or death, basically. They've never really been... And, you know, I look at things a little bit differently. You know, I think Israeli Jews... Look, Israeli Jews never aren't as right-wing as people think they are. I mean, Netanyahu is the prime minister. His party, which is the largest party, the Likud, has 30 seats in parliament out of 120. It's not like, you know, they're even close to being half the seats. If you think about it, there's 800,000 settlers in the occupied territory, which is 10% of the Israeli population. So after 50 years, and billions of dollars and beautiful settlements. You know, they're really, the infrastructure is great, the housing is great. Still, they've managed to attract only 10% of Israelis. And if you look at the real settlers, the ones that are religious, ideological, God gave us this land, they're violent towards the Palestinians, they're 1% of the Israeli population. So I think for Israeli Jews, the issue is security. Personal security, of course, but also collective security. And that gets exactly into this question. There will be a Palestinian majority. What's going to prevent what's going to prevent the parliament from doing to us what we do to them today? The tyranny of the majority. The first day the new states they created, boom, the Palestinian majority makes all kinds of laws, and we turn into Algeria, and the Jews are thrown out. That's where the binational part comes in. Mm-hmm. You see, I think there should be a constitution, which we don't have today.
Right.
And if you embody this principle, it's, you know, every Congress, in American terms, or parliaments, Congress is limited. Congress can't pass any law it wants to pass. You have a constitution, you have the Supreme Court. Laws have to go through be legal in a sense. Well, this parliament also would be limited in the sense that parliament here, of that one state, could not pass laws that harm the integrity of either national group, Palestinian Arabs or Israeli Jews. In other words, you accept that these groups exist, these communities exist, they have their rights, they can have their language, they can have their institutions, they're legitimate, and that, I think, addresses the Israeli concern. So even if Israeli Jews are 20% of the population, they're protected as a community by a constitution and so on. And I think in that, if it's presented in that sort of a way, I think a lot, you know, in which, and everybody has access to the entire country. So you don't have, if you want to live in Hebron as a Jew, you can do that. You can be a Zionist if you want. Nobody's telling you. You just can't privilege yourself over other people. There's equality, but everybody can live everywhere they want to. The refugees come back. That's essential, the right of return. And not only do refugees come back, but you have to have land redistribution and economic assistance. I mean, they have to be able to come back with resources in which they're genuinely able to integrate into society, not just come back and sit in a camp in the Galilee somewhere. So, in other words, if you do this in good faith, and really think through what are the fears and concerns of both sides and try to build that in, I think you can come up with something that, that everybody could buy.
Would reparations not be an issue, though, to...
Reparations? No, for sure.
How do you get around that?
Well, with the refugee issue, I think, and I, again, I think if Israelis are, I think Israelis, you know, I think Israelis do feel that the situation is unsustainable. I mean, we, you know, you can't put your finger on it exactly. There's no big countervailing force today that's stopping Israel. But I think Israelis feel that this, you know, there's a famous story. Amos Oz is a famous Israeli author. And he said once, the last one out of Ben-Gurion Airport, please turn off the lights. There is a sense that, you know, this isn't, you know, we've got to do something. So I think that, now, you know, so with the, I think, again, as a package that addresses all of this, the right of return is essential. And not only that, but you know, like in every other situation, like in South Africa, you have the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Reconciliation becomes a big part of it. You're not going to have healing and closure unless Israel acknowledges what it's done. That's going to be a hard nut to crack. Because, you know, we... Again, we hold ourselves as victims. We're the victims. We don't want to give that up. And by admitting what we did, we, in a sense, jeopardize ourselves. But that has to be done. You're not going to have closure without acknowledgement. And then reparations. In other words, what I'm saying is refugees come back here. Those that want to have the choice. And they get the resources that they need to really integrate. And those that choose not to also get financial compensation, resettlement. You know, I mean, you certainly have to address that.
Sounds great.
My question is, who have you spoken with about this political idea of yours besides groups like us?
And, so,
just curious.
Well, I've written about it in different places.
Someone who is in power or that can actually work on doing something about it.
Right.
You know, you write a book, you know who's going to read your book.
I wrote a book.
Yeah. You give copies to, like, Parliament or the Knesset.
You know, I was in Kansas City. I spoke at a church. it's a real problem. Who I have to talk to, all right, who I have to talk to are our Palestinian partners, first and foremost. Not so much people of power, but... We have to build a grassroots movement. And for different reasons, some of them I mentioned, the Palestinian civil society is really kind of withdrawn into itself more. There's less of a political struggle today. And there's also another problem that I won't get into that's called anti-normalization. I think the Palestinians are feeling very, and I understand them. If I was a Palestinian, I probably wouldn't want to deal with Israelis either. But you know they pulled back from working with Israeli groups, even anti-Zionist groups like ours. Mm-hmm. So there's no communication, there's no forums, there's no meetings. So they're not strategizing among themselves, and they're not strategizing with us. So nothing is there, and that's the nut I'm trying to crack. I'm trying to somehow get some grassroots. 5 people together or something. Even what I've been trying to do is say, okay, if we're not ready for a solution, let's see if we could formulate together a kind of a freedom charter, like the ANC had in South Africa. A vision, we don't even have a vision document of where we're going. But right now, everybody's in a very much of a hunkering down, almost anti-political place today. And it's, so I haven't, I know, I'm telling you, I haven't been able to really bring this idea forward in any meaningful way.
You need a constitutional convention.
Yeah, or even a meeting in a room like this. Yeah.
You mentioned the people in Europe, the United Kingdom and the Spanish.
Yeah.
And basically those are just white people, you know, arguing some kind of religious thing among them. The problem we have here is we have these Europeans that you're talking about from, you know, from Europe coming here and right. treating the locals as subhumans.
Right, that's
the
right.
same story like the same white people right. coming to the U.S. and treating blacks and Spanish and Arabs and the that's rest right. of it subhumans. They are either mm-hmm. killing them every once in a while or not giving them their rights. Or
right.
So that's why the binational
right.
is not really democratic. Yeah. That's the way I think I see it.
Well, look, it's not fair. I mean, I agree with you. Look, there's two narratives. Narrative is a big popular word these days. There's two narratives. I mean, from the Israeli Jewish point of view, you know, we're coming back to our homeland, and, you know, it's a story. Look, every people creates a story. So, you know, I woke up one day when I discovered that actually Davy Crockett surrendered to the Alamo.
Right.
Well, that ended my my belief in national narratives. So everybody makes up a narrative. For Israeli Jews, you know, this idea of return. It's not colonialism, returning to the homeland. But for Palestinians, it definitely is a story of settler colonialism. No different from Australia, South Africa, the United States. And they're right. I mean, in a sense, both sides are right. Because, you know, with a narrative, you can't say. And I think that's something that the Palestinians are going to have to deal with. It was, you know, and I asked about this with some of the people of the ANC in South Africa that I know that were really involved with Mandela and the anti-apartheid movement. Because what happened is, you know, apartheid was imposed in 1948, officially. By 1955, they had the Freedom Charter. And the Freedom Charter said, we're all South Africans. I mean, they knew. I mean, certainly you talk about whites and blacks. There was really whites and blacks in colonialism and a small white minority imposing a system over the black majority and so on. But they said, our vision of a peace is inclusive of everybody. And I think on the basis of that, they were able in the end to do away with apartheid. Because, I mean, it's not fair, but I think the rule, one of the rules of the game is that the oppressor has to be convinced that it will be safe. Or let me put it another way. The oppressed have to convince the oppressors that they'll be safe once the oppression ends.
That the oppressor will be safe.
That the oppressor will be safe. Why should the oppressed have to do that?
Right.
But the oppressors aren't going to give up power if they think they're going to, you know, get killed or whatever. So, the ANC really bit that bullet and said, if we really want a new South Africa, if we really want to end apartheid and build something just, we have to bite that. Now, not everybody agreed with the ANC. You know, Winnie Mandela was involved, and Steve Biko were involved in what was called the Pan-Africanist Conference. They broke away from the ANC. They said, no, this should be a black African country, and those colonialists should go back to wherever they came from, Holland or wherever. But that was a minority voice. The majority voice was the ANC that prevailed. And so, you know, you can simply make the argument that if you want to resolve this in a way that is substantially just, but not absolutely just, of course, you've got to bite that bullet and say, look, the Israeli Jews are here to stay. They're a sociological, political reality. Maybe they shouldn't have been here, but they're here. And now we have to look at this, I think, as a binational state. Now, you don't have to do that, because it's true if it's settler colonialism from your point of view. And you have every right in the world to send not all Israeli Jews are white, a lot of them are Mizrahim, but to send them back. But in doing that, you're going to mess up both your own society and the chances that this will ever be accepted. So, you know, you've got to make those kinds of hard decisions.
The Mizrahim are part of the, basically, Palestinians because they are treated, although inside Israel, as subhumans. Right. They...
Well, they're not subhuman.
Yeah, kind of. They're not treated as the white Europeans.
But one thing I want to say, and I don't want to, really quickly, is that we don't Americanize here. This isn't racialized. There's a conflict. There's national conflicts, religious conflicts, and so on. But it isn't blacks and whites, like in the States. In the States, it's very racialized. Everything is racialized. Here, not so much. The problem isn't color or race or biology. That's not the problem. The problem is more national religious conflicts. But I don't think the Mizrahim are really seen as subhuman, or Arabs. I mean, you don't hear, there's racism against Arabs in the sense that, you know, racism, you know, that they're violent or this or that, that kind of racism. But there's not racism in a biological sense like you hear in the States of, you know, races that have different characteristics and different capabilities and a Steve Bannon kind of a thing. That you don't have, that's the good news. You don't have that here. And that makes it a little bit easier than if it really was racialized. Yeah. I think. That's just.
I'm just wondering, in this binational idea, it sounds great and, you know, probably the solution. But if I mean, what's, say, the Palestinians agree and they write the Constitution, you know, why wouldn't the Israelis think ahead of time that, okay, they'll write a constitution, well, everything will be hunky-dory, and the minute the constitution is employed and we have our equal rights, they'll dissolve the constitution and the Palestinians and kill us and take us over. I mean, why would they think that a constitution is going to, you know, it's just, it would be, I mean, I don't think they'd go along with that.
Look, you have to. It's a process, you know, of nation building, and I think, you know, I think if you get into it in good faith and buy into it, then you wouldn't. I mean, in a sense, I guess you could argue self-interest. What would be their interest in the Palestinians' interest in starting the whole thing again? And then Israel has, you know, has still would have the capabilities of I mean, it doesn't. Yeah. You know,
that doesn't make sense.
In other words, if you convince people that they're really going to benefit more going this way than that way, I think people
Wow.
I mean, I don't have any other. I mean, if somebody else has another way out, I'd be happy to hear it.
Oh, yeah.
That's
incredulous. He wants to stay with equal rights, but I just can't imagine.
Jack is next.
Just picking up on it, you know, if you could probably make a strong case that if you assume that it happened, instead of all the reasons it can't happen, if you assume that it happened and you had people say, if this were equal rights, how much better would the economy and the standard of living be over a period of time?
That's right.
You know, when you get these kids coming out of college and they go to Dubai because, you know, they could just as easily be useful in a way here.
That's right.
But the question I had for you was you made the, I didn't know that Hamas, I mean, there's been a lot of agreements signed that.
Yeah.
But if in fact the militant wing as well as the regular wing was serious and you take terror off the table, doesn't that make it harder to sustain that we're doing all this for security? I mean, if there was a period of quiet, you know, and it was genuine. Doesn't that diffuse the argument?
Yeah, but you can look at it another way too. Once it's quiet, this whole issue just disappears.
No, but followed up by the, I mean, they can always say, you got a good idea, but we can't even address it till the security.
No, but if it's quiet, then why? What motivation do you have to go on and solve it?
Everybody's happy here.
If it's quiet, then. No, just let it go and we stay in power.
But it's quiet, you're in power, but people can't move freely.
No,
there isn't this binational.
That's right.
Why isn't there any great young leader that the Palestinians? You mentioned that. No, but you know, there's got to be. Every country had their oppressors, and they and there was Gandhi, and there was why can't they have?
Well, I think one reason, to tell you the truth, is that Israel either kills them or imprisons them. They nip it in the bud. Israel, I'm telling you, Israel targets Palestinians from the age of 15. And Ilan Pape writes about this in his book, The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine, where they, in 1948, they went into villages with books that were called the village registry. It was like a registry where they had all the names of all the activists that they systematically eliminated. And it's the same here, you know. Anybody that's seen as an up-and-coming leader is targeted and either imprisoned or killed or driven out of the country sometimes. And I think it's very systematic. I think it's really, I mean, it's a campaign that's very targeted. We call it targeted assassinations. Israel invented that term. And I think that that's, you know, it's Israel calls it, there's a term called mowing the lawn. See, that's what it's called. In other words, you know, when a piece of grass sticks up, you mow it. And you just keep it all, you know, like that. And it's an ongoing process.
Well, you got a question?
Thank you. So I wanted to make a short comment. I like your optimism. I don't want to discourage you in any way possible. But I do kind of feel that I have to share this with everybody. It's going to take about a minute. In many ways, I went through wars and what Palestinians are going through every day. I come from Bosnia. And for those who don't know, in 1992, the United Nations recognized Bosnia as an independent country. And then the next day they imposed the embargo, saying, you know what, Serbs have a lot of weapons. If you give it to Bosnians, it's going to be a huge war. So they just have Serbs to Bosnians. So they did that, and they sit back 3 years in front of their eyes in the middle of Europe, and they did nothing. So as soon as they realized that it's not going to work as they planned, so they created these what they called UN safe zones, where they come in, take all of the weapons that we had, and they protect us. And then one day they just invite Serbs and they kill 8,000 people overnight. And then they realize that that's not going to solve the problem. Again, they're not going to just kill them all. So for those who don't know, the only time they sat down and talked about peace and agreement was when we became strong enough that the peace agreement was their best option at the moment. And that's when we signed the agreement. So not only did we create an army, but they were threatening to take over even Serbia. And they said, you know what, it's not going to just stop it. So yes, one state solution, I think that's the only thing that will work here, but not until the Palestinians are strong enough to force them into something what you're suggesting.
But that means with the part of that strength is international community galvanizing and mobilizing and supporting
just the Palestinians. If you watch the calls the last week, they just said, you know what, you guys don't have a strong case to even submit a court appearance to sue Serbia for what they've done.
Are you talking about a Palestinian arm?
Well, I'm talking about being Palestinians strong enough in any way possible, whether it's politics, army, until they become a strong player, and until they're strong enough to sit on the table and talk about solutions, nobody's going to listen to them.
That's right. But they have to run that.
And that's one thing that I'm taking with me from here is I've had so many different things in my mind. But one thing that I'm really happy about is the Palestinians, I believe, understand that it's only them who can change something.
That's right.
And I totally agree. I'm glad that they understand that. How soon it's going to happen, I don't know, but I'm glad they realize that.
I saw
what about
you
this
and
side?
Josh.
This side doesn't have any questions.
So like my question is basically kind of off of Mickey's. I do think that the idea of a binational state is very optimistic. So how would you convince? So right now the reason why Israel is doing so well is primarily a lot of it due to foreign powers, right? Foreign aid. Right, and then there is a lot of success going back and forth. So the foreign aids are benefiting from the idea that Israel is prospering. So how would you convince these foreign powers, that the idea of a binational state would be much better, with the fact that the investments wouldn't be as high, the military occupation wouldn't be as necessary, and like all these other like ideas. And like secondly, like the second fold, is that I think that a lot of the idea of the state working, right, comes from this like this concept that you brought up a couple times of like it being ideal or it being better or like it being like optimistic or something like that. Mm-hmm. So I think the idea of like repercussions and like land distribution wouldn't really be solved, right, with the plan that you had forth, which would kind of put us back at square one.
Right. I don't know. Look, my I have this running discussion with church people. They say, they always say at the end, give me some hope. And I say, you know, I'm not in the hope business. I don't believe in hope. You know, Israel didn't take over because it hoped it was going to take over. Corporations don't run the world because they hope that they can. You know, they have strategies and they struggle, and I believe in struggle. But it has to be strategic. So that I'm not being optimistic. I'm trying to be a player. I'm trying to say if we don't come up with our own program, then we can't complain if Israel is, I mean, Israel's doing what it should be doing, winning. You know, wow. But it's winning because there's no pushback. There's no, wow. And I think that if we came up with, I think in a sense, the Palestinian people are mobilized. I mean, every day they struggle and suffer and die. And you guys are mobilized. I mean, the Palestinian issue has become, I think, a global issue.
Yeah.
I think the Palestinian issue has achieved the proportions of the anti-apartheid struggle all over the world. But what we're lacking is the ask. So people are saying, oh, we're, you know, I'll tell you just a little quick story. I was in Asheville, North Carolina. A couple months ago, I gave my talk. Is that where you're from? I gave a talk at the library, and this guy got up and he said to me, nicely, but he said to me, "You know what? I've been listening to you for 20 years now." He says, "To your credit, you change your presentation, so it's not. Thank you for that." But I get it already. I get it. Occupation, human rights, Israelis, I get it. What do you want? Give me my marching orders. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to support? What do you want me to go tell my representative? You can't just say, you know, there's a house demolition and my representative is going to write a letter. And there's this, and there's this, and there's this. You've got to give me a plan. And I don't have an answer for that. I mean, I get into this whole thing, but we don't have, and so in a sense, we don't know what our strength is, because we don't know whether this is pie in the sky, or if optimistic, or if it's realistic, or how governments would react. I mean, there's a lot of governments that are actually very sympathetic to the Palestinians. So we gave them ammunition, and gave them a plan and a direction and leadership coming from the Palestinians. I think we really could begin to change the political dynamic, just like we did with apartheid.
So,
but if we don't, we can't complain.
So it wouldn't necessarily, so this is just an idea of like starting the conversation, it wouldn't necessarily be something that you believe that would be like fundamentally feasible for the actual state.
Yeah, I want us to come up with what do we want?
Okay.
What do we want? A political program.
Why is it that you think that Israel will accept just this if the Palestinians can come up with a good plan? And they'll accept it?
No, not that easily.
I mean, so I'm trying to figure out.
It's a struggle.
What is it that you are asking Palestinians to do? Find a leader, come up with a plan, and offer it to Israel?
No. It's much more complicated. I mean, it's more complicated. It's just, you know, just like, you know, I mean, the ANC in South Africa had an international strategy. They didn't just sit down and try to talk to the Afrikaners or even the military wing. They had their best people were out all over the world mobilizing so that, you know, they got governments on their side. I'll tell you just one little tiny thing. I know you guys got to go. the Algerian Revolution. Here, we're in the middle of the Cold, on the height of the Cold War. We're talking about the 1950s. Dulles is Secretary of State, this super anti-communist guy. Here are the Algerian rebels, Arabs, Muslims, terrorists. I mean, they use terrorism outright, not just terrorism in Algeria, in France. Terrorism, a liberation front. I can't think of worse images for the United States in 1959. You know, but they sent their best people abroad. They knew they weren't going to beat France militarily. They could do things that kept them on the map, you know, but that in the end they had to have international backing. They got, think about this, 1960, they got, and Kennedy, this is one of the big issues that Kennedy supported the Algerian in the struggle. They got the Algerian Muslim Arab terrorist liberation movement got Red China, the Soviet Union, and the United States together against France.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
France almost got thrown out of NATO because it was using NATO weapons against the Algerians. Whoa, if you could do that, so the Palestinians, and I'm talking about the now, of course, the mainly the authority, but the Palestinians don't have an international strategy. They're not mobilizing. And if they did, I think they could really do what the Algerians did.
So I thought I heard you say that the Palestinian struggle was now an international one.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but it, you said it's not organized enough to be enough to make the Israelis.
That's right. You're mobilizable, but you're not mobilized.
We're not mobilized enough. So the world hasn't come together in one kind of powerful way enough to make the Israelis change their mind.
Right.
And we have to make Israelis change their mind so that they can also feel good about it.
But the Palestinians have to be the ones
to feel secure.
That's right.
But it has to be done through the voice and leadership.
Of the Palestinians.
Strong leadership of the Palestinians.
That's right.
That's what you're saying. And
that's
you believe that.
I mean, you can't liberate Palestine on your own.
So you just have to force it. I mean,
there has to be leadership. There has to be a direction given.
And it is by force.
No, not necessarily by force. But force can also be BDS.
Yes.
It can be. There's a lot of force besides armed force.
But that's force, right?
Yeah. No, for sure. For sure. For sure.
Carolyn, you get the last question.
Right. So, on a personal note, I'd like to know.
I'm just trying to figure it out.
Okay.
I'd like to know why you came to Israel in 73. And
you're going to the airport in 5 minutes.
Have you ever considered returning to the U.S.?
No, I wouldn't go back to the belly of the beast.
This is not the beast.
And I don't know. Everybody has their own biography and everything. For me, there was kind of a push and a pull. Here's some, a little bit of, I don't know for everybody, but here's some propaganda of ours, our committee that you can share. Just in a word, you know, it's like some of us here, I'm an old 60s museum piece. I did everything you were supposed to do in the 60s. I grew up with Bob Dylan.
Yeah.
I was in jail in Mississippi. I was an anti-Vietnam War draft resister. I was in Woodstock. By chance, but I was at Woodstock. I was at the Chicago Convention in 1968. Almost the only thing I didn't do was I wasn't a hippie in Haight-Ashbury. So I did. You trumped me. In that sense. Okay, that word again. So I've always been very political, you know. I was the class of 68 in the university, and that was the political height of the 60s. Well, you know, I guess, you know, personally, when Nixon came in and all of that, I just said I really wanted to leave. I never felt, and I still feel this way, anything transcendent about life in the United States. It was all just the everyday routine and materialism, and it wasn't especially bright country, and I just didn't like it, that's all. Nothing bad ever happened to me in the U.S., you know, I mean, and I appreciate the U.S., but it I just didn't feel, I felt more and more alienation, I think, especially as the 60s started to collapse. And then I was looking for somewhere, first of all, where I could go and be politically active. I mean, I could have moved to France, like I have a good friend that moved to Paris the same time I came here. And we meet sometimes, and I wonder, who made the best decision? I could have been 45 years in Paris. But, you know, I couldn't get up in Paris and tell the French how to vote. Here I had a certain, you know, legitimacy in that sense. And I was active, I never was a Zionist, but I was active in the peace movement. So in a sense, using 60s language, I simply came to another front in the revolution. You know, and I felt here I could be more useful. It was maybe a smaller pond. It was out in the world. It was dealing with all these issues. And so I think it's true. I think maybe in the States, you know, you tend to get lost on so huge, you know, that you don't have the impact. Some people have the impact at the local level or whatever. But I guess here I felt like, you know, something different.